I'm Nick Pettit.
I'm Jason Seifer.
And you're watching the Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets where we talk about all things web design, web development, and more.
In this episode, we'll be talking about explaining CSS, JavaScript charts, and landing pages.
Last week, I was out due to a bizarre faux hawk incident. I don't really want to go into the details. It was pretty gnarly. It's a little emotional. And fortunately, my faux hawk's grown back.
Just glad everything's okay.
Smell real nice. First up is CSS Explain, which is this nifty little website where you can go ahead and type in a CSS selector. So I'm going to use the example that they have here of li.active strong. And just below, it will tell me what kind of CSS selector it is. So in this case, it's tag selector. And I have to say this really slowly. It also tells you the CSS selector specificity.
That is a tough one to get right.
It is. But it's a pretty nifty tool. A lot of times when you're creating a lot of CSS, it can be a little difficult knowing how strong a selector is, what type of selector you're actually using, and what it's going to select on the page. And I like this tool because sometimes if you're not specific enough, it will tell you that the selector is actually universal. So this is pretty good if you're trying to debug CSS and you just want to make sure that you're typing in the right thing. It's a good sanity check.
Yeah, this actually works off of the W3C's CSS specificity specification.
Sounds pretty official.
Yeah, I just wanted to say all that because that was probably the most difficult thing I've done all day. Next up, we have something called xCharts. xCharts is a D3-based library for making charts in JavaScript. It uses the D3JS library for manipulating HTML, CSS, and SVG, so these charts are going to be scalable. Now, the charts are actually really, really pretty and easy to use on the website. On the demo, they have just a regular bar chart. As soon as you go in, you can also make line charts, and there's a ton of different examples, bar charts, multi-series bar charts, line charts, and in addition to just being able to make charts and make them look well, they have a ton of different methods and events that you can use when creating these charts in JavaScript. So really, really nice plugin, very, very easy to use, and we will have a link to this in the show notes at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
Pretty nifty.
Yeah.
Next up is Lorem Pixel. So you've heard of Lorem Ipsum text, right? That's the text that you use that doesn't really mean anything. It kind of looks like Latin, but it's not. It's just gibberish.
They just use that for placeholders mainly when creating.
Exactly. So when you're designing in the browser, sometimes you'll use Lorem Ipsum text to go ahead and hold the place of where, you know, real text would normally be. Well, Lorem Pixel does the same thing, but for images. So let's say that you had an image that was going to be 935 pixels by 393. That's very specific. And I want this to be a picture of, say, nature. I can go ahead and click that I want this to be a color image. And it will go ahead and generate that for me. And then it will load up this nice picture of nature at exactly the size that I specified. Pretty amazing.
It is a beautiful picture of nature.
It is a really nice picture of nature. But it's pretty useful. You know, designing in the browser is obviously a very popular technique. So this is pretty cool that you can just go ahead and drop in placeholder images. It's always best, actually, to try and use real content whenever possible, especially with text, because you never know, you know, how long or short text is actually going to be. So if you have real content, you should use that. But that's not always possible. And in those cases, a tool like this is really useful.
Yeah, that's great. You know, we've talked about placeholder images before, but they basically just specified the size, or it was like a, you know, a gradient picture. But having something that is an actual picture that goes along with your content is very beneficial.
Yeah, it makes it a little more realistic.
Next up, we've got the Node Beginner Book. This is a free and pay book that you can get on the internet, which tells you all about Node.js. So right now, if you want to just go online and read it for free, you can. You can also buy a bundle to get a PDF and EPUB version with free updates. This is a great book that goes through everything that you need to get up and running with Node.js. Shows you how to build a Hello World application, even goes through building HTTP servers, and has a great introduction to JavaScript as well. I'm not going to get into everything this book goes over because it's really long, as you can tell from all this scrolling.
I was hoping you're going to read the entirety of the book to me right now.
That's going to be the extended episode of the Treehouse Show. I'll read all of this.
I'm looking forward to it.
But it's a great book, so go ahead and check that out.
Pretty nifty. Next up is a really cool blog post, and it's a 50-point checklist for creating the ultimate landing page. And we're going to look at all 50 points one at a time right now.
Awesome.
First up is using the checklist. So we're already off to a great start. We're using this checklist right now. We'll just go over a couple of these points here. And basically, they ask just really good questions about landing pages. Landing pages, of course, being for marketing purposes. You know, it's something that you would link on, say, Twitter or, you know, social media channels, and it would send your users to a specific page that has, say, a call to action, where you would go ahead and sign up or learn more about the product. So some of these questions are things like, does your landing page headline match the message on your ads? So for example, if you had some ads that had particular marketing messaging, you'd want to make sure that when a user clicks on that, they're taken to a landing page where the messaging matches that and you have consistent brand messaging so that they know that, okay, that ad I just clicked on is linked to this thing that I'm looking at now. Is your landing page messaging focused on a single purpose? So, you know, is it focused? Another one here is, do you have a simple secondary description to enhance the headline? So all sorts of really cool, just quick sanity checks. You know, does this make sense? And it helps you to look at your landing pages from a couple different perspectives.
That's so, probably going to be really good, you know, if you're not too experienced creating landing pages, or maybe it's one of your first few tries.
Yeah, exactly. If you don't have a really good gut feel for whether or not a landing page is good, this will help you run down a couple of things that you might not have considered.
That's awesome. Next up, we have a project called alertify.js. This is built as an unobtrusive and customizable JavaScript notification system. Now, it offers a few different pieces of functionality with dialogues, kind of modal dialogues, letting you dismiss messages or enter some information, click cancel or OK. And then if you look on the bottom right of the screen, you can see that it'll actually tell me when I click cancel. This is also going to be really useful when you want to have custom log messages. You can see as I'm clicking the different kinds, they just roll in on the bottom. And this is going to be something that's really useful when you are debugging your applications, say in development. You could, of course, use the console.log functionality that's built into most of the different browsers these days, or you could use this library maybe to, you know, if you only need to display a little bit of information. But yeah, it's a great project. It would also be really useful maybe for giving your users messages as they're using your application. But yeah, great project. And, you know, once again, we'll have a link to that in the show notes for alertify.js.
Sweet. Next up is Bootsnipp. This is going to be the last thing we're covering today. If I just go ahead and click on snips here, you get this really nice gallery of design patterns that you can use in a Bootsnipp project. So say, for example, that you wanted to go ahead and create a search bar. Click on view for that. And right here, they have all of the code that you need to go ahead and put together and style that search bar. There's a couple of other common ones here, such as a sign-up form, a one-month calendar. And right here, they have one for vacation rentals, which, Jason, that would be really good for the time-sharing website that you wanted to tell me all about.
Yeah, definitely want to get in on the ground floor of that one.
Yeah, okay, cool. Well, I'm looking forward to that.
I'll have to check out Bootsnipp.
Yeah. No,
so this is just for Twitter Bootstrap, or does it work with Zurb Foundation? I would suppose, since it's called Bootsnipp, it's Bootstrap-based?
It's probably, yeah, specific to Bootsnipp.
All right.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
Sorry.
So that's all we got for this episode, huh?
Yep, that's it.
Who are you on Twitter?
I'm at NickRP.
And I am at JSeifer. Thanks so much for tuning in to this episode of the Treehouse Show. If you want more information on anything that we talked about, check out our show notes at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
And of course, if you'd like to see more videos like this one, you can check us out at teamtreehouse.com. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next week.
If you'd like to see more advanced videos and tutorials like this one, go to teamtreehouse.com and start learning for free.